On today's show,
we discuss the Warriors remaining undefeated and whether Manu Ginobili is calling it quits.
Vince Carter returns to the show to play Rate That Thing.
And can the Celtics stay hot? We'll get you all set for tonight's Game 4 in Cleveland.
It's Tuesday, May 23rd. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Whether you're listening to the podcast, joining us live right now on NBA TV, or later on YouTube, we're very, very happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Thank you for joining us.
There he is. To his right, the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend, Lily.
Lily, and last, certainly not least, over yonder, it is the bearded one. It's Trey Kirby.
Hey!
TK, what's up, man?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag TheStarters. And when I was checking those tweets, came across an incredible piece of Starters fan art. Came to us from a guy named Brian Doyle, who told us his Spanish teacher gave his class an assignment to come up with a new holiday. So he created Dia del Wedgie, a day to celebrate wedgies. I'm just going to guess he got an A+ on this project because look at that incredible board. But it brings us to today's question. What are some other Starters holidays? Like, for instance, we know that May 10th is actually Wedgie Day. Don't know if it coincides with Dia del Wedgie, but probably. You could also have January 18th be Starters Day, since that's when the show was founded, but I've heard it's called TBJ Day in Canada. And of course, Lee's birthday is next week, so maybe May 28th could be a very solid day.
I like that.
Yeah, I'm sure you would. Only bounce passes thrown on that day, but we want to hear from you, so let us know on Twitter. What are some other Starters holidays? Send us your best tweets to hashtag TheStarters. We'll hear from you later.
All right, get your tweets in. Fun show tonight. Half man, half amazing, full-time Starters guest. Mm-hmm. Vince Carter will join us live in studio, and we'll look ahead to Game 4 between the Celtics and the Cavs. But first, a little true or false, playoffs edition. Trey's got the true or false questions. We've got the answers. TK, take it away.
In the one half, Kawhi Leonard played in the Western Conference Finals. The Spurs beat the Warriors by 20 points, but in the 3.5 games the two teams played without Leonard on the floor, the Warriors won by 84 points on their way to a sweep. Kind of impossible to figure out, but true or false, the Spurs would have lost this series even with Kawhi.
I think that's true. When they're basically saying the Warriors are a better team than us, when Manu Ginobili is saying, we got to play at a 10 and they got to play at a 7. They're just that much better. When Greg Popovich is basically saying, they're so good, I don't know how you guard them in news conferences. I think it's fair to say that this team is about flow, mm-hmm. and they had to get game one. They had to get game one because as soon as the Warriors find that flow with all that talent they have going on, they were going to win, you know, four of the next, whatever it was, five or six. So after game one was done, I think it was over, even though I'm sure this Greg Popovich-led team wanted to beat this Warriors team, this era of the Warriors team. They haven't been able to beat them quite yet.
Yeah, they wouldn't have got swept, I don't think. I think they probably would have got one game one, in fact. I think the Spurs, 23 points up, they looked pretty good in that game. The Warriors didn't look great. San Antonio's known for its depth. But in this series, they really got beaten up. They came in without Tony Parker. Then they lose Leonard. And David Lee was also out after game three. Now, the Spurs, those players who came in and replaced the minutes were okay, but they couldn't replace the quality of play that you get from Kawhi Leonard at both ends of the floor. And they were just outnumbered and outgunned. And really, I mean, the Warriors are a fantastic team. No real health concerns. I know Zaza missed a little bit of time there. But other than that, the Warriors were just a better team anyway.
Yeah, the NBA, unfortunately, is a what if sport when you get into the postseason. And you just go back to the last couple of years, you look in the finals, what if Kyrie and Love don't get injured? Do the Warriors still win that title? And then last year, it's what if Steph isn't injured heading into that finals? And what if Draymond doesn't get suspended? It's always what if, what if, what if. You know, I agree with you, Lee. I don't think it's a sweep if Kawhi doesn't get hurt in game one and has the ankle injury even heading into this series from the Rocket series before. Do they win one or two? Yeah, I definitely think it's in play, but I still agree with you guys. I think the Warriors, like we all had, like most people had heading into the series, would still have come out on top, regardless of Kawhi's there. But it's a fun what-if, I guess.
And Kawhi, when Kawhi goes down, LaMarcus Aldridge had 11 points averaging through games two and
four. He didn't step up.
That was disappointing, I'm sure, for Pop and the Spurs.
All right, Trey, next one.
If last night was the last time we see Manu Ginobili on an NBA court, at least he got sent off in style. It started at the opening tip when Manu got his first start in three seasons, then immediately scored the Spurs' first basket, and it lasted right to the end when Manu got a huge ovation from the Spurs faithful and even a few of the Warriors. So guys, what do you think? True or false? That was Manu's last game.
I hope it's false. I would like to see him come back.
What does your heart say? What does your gut say, though?
Well, honestly, for the last 3 or 4 years, I've thought this is probably the last season. I thought after the 2013 finals, he was definitely done because he had a bad final series against the Heat. But he came back, and he came back again and again. The reason why I think he might come back is because you know the Spurs are going to win 50 games. They're going to be in the top four in the Western Conference. So his team is still contending. If he was on a rebuilding team, I think perhaps he would walk away from that. But with San Antonio, you know they're always competitive. You expect Buford and Pop are going to make a few changes in the offseason, bring in some new talent. So if Manu thinks we're a chance to win the championship, then I'm going to come back. If he thinks perhaps this is a year we're not going to do it, that may influence his decision to walk away now.
I'd guess he's coming back. He had 15, 17, and 21 in 3 of his last 4 games. I'm sure that feels good going into the offseason. If they have a healthy Kawhi Leonard, I'm sure he's thinking, you know, we've got a chance against this Golden State Warriors team. And as I mentioned earlier, they want to knock off this era of the Golden State Warriors. They want one more shot. So who really knows? I don't think Manu even knows. I don't think he's lying to us when he says he's going to take some time and think about it himself. I'd say one other argument for him coming back, because he's come off the bench his entire career, he's not even in the top 250 minutes played amongst NBA players. Mm-hmm. He's averaged 26 minutes throughout his career. He's obviously played a ton for Argentina, but at the same time, it's going to be a feel thing for the next few weeks with Manu. He's going to decide on his own terms. No matter what we say here, it's up to him.
Say Argentina again.
That's how you say it.
I know, it's
Spanish.
Great. That's fantastic. Yeah. I wasn't mocking you.
Other
I just wanted to
have
hear
languages.
It again.
No, I can't say it again.
Tease. All right, final one.
Through 3 rounds of the playoffs, the Golden State Warriors are a perfect 12-0. Good for the best record ever heading into the NBA Finals, and they've done it in style, winning games by an average of 16.3 points per game throughout the postseason. But there hasn't been a sweep in the final since 2007, so true or false, the Warriors have a real shot at going 16-0 in the playoffs.
Come on. This is false.
Is it that far-fetched? Is it only because LeBron's over in the East? If it was any other team? This is the most dominant run we've ever seen in the playoffs. It is.
Sure. Yes, it is. Yeah, and nothing to take away from the Warriors. I would make them the favorite, obviously. If, you know, come June 1st, I'm probably picking the Warriors.
Right.
But this is LeBron James.
Right. That's what I'm saying. If it's not LeBron, if LeBron is not there, and I think it's against any other team, I think you'd realistically be going, yeah, they could do this. They just went 12-0 and have the best point per game differential, you know, best average scoring margin entering the NBA Finals we've ever seen. Better than Jordan's Bulls, better than Kareem's, couple of his teams. You know, the 0-1 Shaq Lakers, like, that's insane.
Yeah, but they crushed in the first 2 rounds, too, and you guys still picked the Spurs, or the Warriors in 5. Still gave the Spurs the game.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. And they probably would have got one if Kawhi didn't get injured.
Yeah, I just can't see LeBron getting swept in the finals. I just don't think that's going to happen.
That's nuts. This is the guy we just talked about as the last few weeks as the best player in the world, over and over and over. So the best player in the world is not going to get a game in the NBA Finals? That's nutty. The last team that got swept was LeBron James and his 2007 Cavs. Playing with, you know, Sasha Pavlovich and friends. I mean, he's playing with Kyrie and Kevin. If they can't get a game, that's nuts.
Right. If the Warriors go on to win the title, which a lot of people will be picking them, they're going to give us, in theory, the best record ever since we've gone to the 7-7-7-7 playoff format. The Spurs back in 2007, I believe, they were the best in that era. They went 16-4.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people talk about the 2001 Lakers going 15-1. It was the shorter first round series. So the Warriors just got to win. You're not going to lose 4 games if they're going to win the title, so they're automatically going to have it. So.
Yeah.
I agree with you guys, though. I think it's false because LeBron is going to be there.
Yeah.
He's winning at least one game.
I mean, if they're down 3-0, that would be crazy enough.
He's not getting swept.
All right. Well, let's hear from the people out there. Jump on Twitter. Let us know, true or false. But when we come back, Vince Carter is back.
He's back.
VC joins us live in studio. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to The Starters, where we're ecstatic to once again welcome back 8-time All-Star and now 2-time Starters guest, Grizzly Slimman.
Took the words out of my mouth.
Yeah, that's exactly right, man. We appreciate you coming back. Nearly a year to the day that you were in studio here.
All about timing.
We had such a blast with you last time, with you judging things, that we're running it back.
Let's do it.
It's time to rate that thing with Vince Carter.
Let's go.
And if you're new to the show, you know, this is where we flip the script. We let VC here judge some things. He's always being judged, be it in dunk contests, in-game performances, Hall of Fame credentials. He's in charge today. He's the judge. So just like last time,
Boss.
We'll show you a series of things, ask you a series of questions, and you will rate them. using the dry erase board there.
All right.
One being
fancy pen.
One being low, 10 being high.
Spared no expense.
We knew
you were coming in.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. We actually lost the flip books at All Star Weekend, and we don't have the budget to get more.
Right. It happens. I could have brought mine from home.
Yeah. Sorry. All right. Well, look. Our first thing here. One of your older NBA comrades, Manu Ginobili, maybe played his last game last night. We're still waiting to find out if he's going to officially retire. But you battled this guy multiple times. So on a scale of 1 to 10, the rate, the difficulty level in guarding Manu Ginobili over the years.
And 10 being what?
10 being the toughest.
Difficult.
Yes.
And 1 being what?
The easiest.
Okay, one moment.
Okay.
Wow.
He might be on to 100 here.
Oh, boy. Thinks highly of him? Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Nearly the perfect 10. So. Yeah. Extremely difficult.
It's the first question. I can't give him a 10.
That's fair.
If you'd asked me at the end, you'd have got a 10.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's crafty. He was one of the first. I'm not going to say he was the first. You know, it's kind of cloudy with the Euro step thing, but he was one of the first. And, you know, just guarding him, it was, first of all, that's an offensive foul. You can't commit. let's get that out there now. But, I mean, he was very crafty. He uses his body well. And let me. This is great. I'm glad you showed it. Let me. Faith plant. Let me explain to the Spurs fan. You know, that wasn't intentional. Right. That's two old guys who don't really have good breaks.
Just taking a tumble in there.
And it's like, well, you're on the bottom. I can't stop. This is what happens. You know, but I mean, it's been a lot of battles like that. And he's, like I said, he's a crafty guy he's a champion. And he knows how to play the game. And, you know, when you have lefties who are like that, I mean, it's so many right-handed players in the game, and you scout so much for right-handed players. You get a left-handed guy like that who can drive, very athletic, can shoot the ball. And he just has the awkiness in his game, if you would. And it's just tough to guard sometimes. I mean, even when you think you have him guarded, he's going to give you a pump fake. Could flop. You know, I don't know if he flops, but, you know that's why that's why I really took the 0.5 off.
You're an honest man.
All right, before you grade this next one, we got to show you another play from that series with the Spurs. You and Kyle Anderson getting into it a little bit. He didn't like how he was roughing you up a little bit coming around the screen. He gave the kid some words, but then he dunked it and cranked it up. He used the Vince Carter move right in front of you. It was subtle. It was a subtle little crank. That's Vince's move.
That was smart. He did it. He did it to the bench, to them, because, you know.
That's
all I know.
Because you didn't see it live then.
No, I didn't see it.
No.
So it's first time seeing that.
Oh, wow. Oh. That's your first time. Okay, right. So rank, give us the grade.
On the
crank it up celebration from Kyle Anderson.
I'm gonna give him a 1.
Mm-hmm. That's kind. That's kind of you.
Because I mean, he didn't ask for permission to use it.
Oh,
right. He stole it. I'll give him a 1. Yeah.
Location.
No, that's fair.
Like,
that's
location. That's the. You know, we up here. We're up here.
Yeah.
Normally,
yeah.
You know,
come on,
big
ride.
Bikes.
Big bikes.
You know, usually down here, little bikes. Those are. What do we say?
Pee-wee bikes.
Yeah, you said not me.
All right, next one here.
We're going to take the lob. You got it. That was good.
Well, earlier this season, I guess it was late January, you pulled off this remarkable 360 layup in traffic. And this was the night before you turned 40. So the very next day, we had our resident 40-year-old Lee Ellis give it a go.
Hey, he made it.
Well,
not as smooth.
Okay,
it doesn't matter.
He didn't make it. So we want you to rate the Lee Ellis 360 layup.
Can I see that one more time?
Can we run it back?
Do we have slow mo?
well, it is actually in.
That was slow mo.
There it is.
Oh yeah.
And.
Close to a 360.
Bear in mind, I'm wearing jeans as well.
Oh, yeah. Right. Jeans excuse. Right. So rate the Lee Ellis 360.
So he made it.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't very fluid.
Wasn't beautiful.
Yeah, so there's the minus. he didn't fall over or hurt himself, so there's another plus.
Well, you didn't see me the next day, actually. I was a bit sore.
Even better. 7.
Okay, ooh, not badly.
Strong.
It's all right,
Strong.
It's all right.
Let's go this way. 7.
It's all right, give me something to work on.
Yeah.
You know. Come back next year.
Fluidity is what we're looking for here, baby.
That's right.
Okay, next one. Your Grizzlies head coach, David Fizdale, was on ESPN's The Jump. This is a different one. Before we get to that one, this is the time where he told The Jump that you built the room in your house for rookie Deonte Davis to come over whenever he felt the mood because you were the vet, you know, putting your arm around the guy, helping him out a little bit. So let's rate Vince Carter the landlord. How would you rate yourself as a landlord?
Fall behind on rent.
Yeah, are you strict?
Yeah.
Are you a neat freak? Huh?
I got a curfew.
I think this is going to tell it all.
Okay. I like how much
nobody.
Wow!
100.
I mean, yeah. You built a room.
Oh yeah, I forgot the point.
Cleanliness.
We want it clean. Yeah. You know. Wash off yourself, tend to wash the sheets, make up the bed sometimes. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what I was taught. So, I mean,
wow.
Come on, we got to keep a clean home, man.
All right, you know? All right, excellent.
That was a cool move, though.
I told him that. That's why he didn't come as often, probably. You know, like, hold up.
This guy's
built
tough.
The room for me, but I have rules? Absolutely.
Yeah. Right. Absolutely. All right, next one guy, here. Though. Once Upon a Time, you were in the 2002 film, Like Mike, starring Little Bow Wow.
I was.
The key scene here, yeah, Bow Wow got you on the pump fake. The Ginobili pump fake there, got you.
He did.
He set up the game-winning shot. So we need you to rate Little Bow Wow's pump fake.
It took me a while to buy into this because I didn't want him to score.
Right.
not in one segment. I didn't want to be in anything with him scoring because he's a friend of mine. But, you know, Bow Wow really thinks he's an NBA player. So, you know, the pump fake was weak, so I really had to go for it.
Right.
We're being honest here.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Honest, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
6.3. Very precise.
Yeah. We're precision. Precision.
All right. Final one here comes by way.
A little score for Lil Bow Wow.
This one comes from the Grizzlies social media team. This is unbelievable. This is you at the age of 40 there. You splashed a three from half court. We didn't
show
that.
Yeah, you got to show the lead up. It's all about setup, man.
But then you drop the between the legs dunk. Yeah. So judge the dunk there.
Judge the dunk. One more time. I got
run it back.
Couple things I'm looking for here.
Okay.
You know, first time seeing this too?
This is my second.
Okay.
Of
I mean, that's a casual lead.
Oh, man.
Legs
imagine
up.
Dunking through Full the legs extension. So many times you have to keep track of
them.
Only you, man.
Yeah, that has to be a 10.
Yes. Follow-up question. I've always wanted to know, who slams harder, Onyx or Vince Carter?
Vince Carter.
Oh, yeah.
And I told him that. Sure, I know that. I know that.
We can't thank you enough.
I didn't know I could do that.
That was
I didn't realize he was filming, but that was like, hey, I made it. I was feeling good. Let me try it. And it worked out, thank goodness.
First time.
So that could have gone one of two ways. I could have been here putting a 0.5.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, thank goodness. Hey.
Thanks for coming on, Vince. Appreciate
thanks
it.
For having me.
Catch Vince on Game Time later tonight, right after the starters, but after the jump, we'll look ahead to tonight's Game 4 of the Eastern Conference Finals. Can the King rebound? Very, very likely.
It's possible.
Very likely. Yeah, it's possible.
The Starters on NBA TV is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey, proud partner of the NBA. Do your friends proud. Please drink responsibly.
Not long now till Game 4 of the Eastern Conference Finals between the Celtics and Cavs. There's the hero from Game 3, Marcus Smart, and there is the King, LeBron James. Coverage get started at 8 p.m. Eastern on TNT. But a quick look ahead as we get into this huge game tonight on TNT. Trey, you got the questions.
Yep, despite trailing by as many as 21 in the second half, the Celtics pulled off an incredible comeback to win Game 3. So heading into Game 4 tonight, can the Celtics repeat their Game 3 performance?
I doubt it. They had a lot of things go their way. They had a 21-point lead evaporate. They had Smart have the best shooting game of his career. They had LeBron James go for 11, and they still only won by a game winner that bounced around five times. I think the Cavs win this one. They just had so many things go their way. Will they all go that way? You know, and it was only a buzzer beater. I doubt it.
LeBron is one of those superstars who sometimes just needs that little motivation to go out there and say, all right, I gave you guys a game. Now I'm going to go back there, finish this series off as quick as I can, especially knowing that the Warriors are on break until the finals next week. So I think LeBron's going to be a little bit more focused and determined tonight. I think you're going to see Kyrie, Kevin Love, everyone trying to step up and say that last game we were bad. We're going to own it. We're going to go out there and make the corrections tonight.
If Marcus Smart hits 7 or more three-pointers in tonight's game, I will do nothing but eat beans on tomorrow's show for Bean Town. Brown beans, pinto beans, kidney beans, all the beans. I'll eat beans throughout the entire show. He's not hitting 7 threes again. That was unbelievable.
Not going 7
the Celtics, you know, they're going to jack up another 40 three-point attempts. This is going to be their best chance to honestly win these games. They went 18 of 40 in Game 3 after struggling in Game 1 and 2, but I don't think Marcus Smart is going to have that 27 points. He was a big part of that comeback, right? Because he hit those three threes there in that stretch that suddenly you were looking at the score, you're like, whoa, the Celtics are somehow back in this game. that's not happening. And if it does, I'm going to eat a bunch of beans on Toronto.
Well, from
and
the
you
Celtics,
guys are going to pay for it.
From the Celtics perspective, though, Bradley and Horford weren't great.
Right.
And then they somehow pulled this one out.
Jerebko gave them some really good minutes as well. Again, I think the Cavs will live with all those things happening again in game four. It's not going to repeat itself.
LeBron triple-double tonight?
Sure.
Goodness, we stand by it. When we return, Lee has a special Ginobili edition of VSP. Don't go anywhere. We asked you, what are some other potential starters holidays? You hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Trey, you got a few of the best answers.
Yeah, some good ones. This one comes from Wissam, who says, Fashion or Nah Day would be fun. We'd have judges on every street corner just judging random people's outfits. Fun for everyone. Mahad says, That'll do day. Spend the entire day giving your lowest effort. My favorite answer comes from Baby Blake, who says, Well, for all of us watching, every day the starters are on is a holiday. Hey, man. You're welcome.
Thanks, Baby Blake.
Love you.
All right, no very solid play here on tonight's show. You got a Ginobili twist for us, Lili.
Yeah, hopefully this is not the last time we see Manu on the court, but if it is, I thought I'd just compile my favorite five Manu Ginobili passes.
Mm-hmm.
At number five, this incredible baseline hammer action that he fires over to Danny Green in the corner for a swish bomb. This is just a perfect Manu play. Look at that. Probably went out of court too, you know, over the end line there. It was gorgeous. Number four, you haven't made it in the NBA until you've been nutmegged by Manu Ginobili. There's easily a top 10 list
of
this. Tayshaun Prince here doing a job. Going out, beautiful finish there from Corey Joseph. This is a classic Manu. Spurs, the play nearly becomes a turnover, instead turns into a gorgeous pass from Manu to DeJean Blair for a beautiful layup. Here it is again, look at that.
Just looking at him the whole way.
And finishes. Now Matt Bonner nearly gets decapitated in this play here. Watch this for a pass.
That's a red rocket for him.
He might have a career in baseball if he doesn't retire from the NBA. Beautiful play, beautiful finish. But I had to finish on just a classic Manu here. Look at this pass to Patty Mills for a gorgeous finish. You notice a lot of layups in this as well, because that's what I love about it as well. Just beautiful Manu plays, beautiful passes, beautiful finishes. That's what I call beautiful Manu Ginobili plays.
Excellent. Excellent stuff. All right, on the Twitter show this morning, live on Twitter, we had a blast. We talked about Manu Ginobili in great detail, Celtics, Cavs, the Warriors sweeping the Spurs, and a few of my favorite NBA gifts. When people say, like, the greatest NBA GIF or GIF, however you want to call it, of all time, a lot of the times the Raptors one comes up, the deflating Raptors, which is very, very funny and is always funny, especially when the tail drops. But the Tim Duncan Ginobili GIF of bald spot and Duncan doing that weird little, like move to his head and it closes the bald spot is, it's one of the best. It is one of the best. There's no doubt. Game four. Tonight, Celtics, Cavs, Boston trying to even up the series. The King trying to bounce back from that 11-point performance in Game 3. Enjoy the game. We'll see you tomorrow night.
All right. Thank you for joining us, folks. And remember, most biker crews are intimidating, except for this one. Well, Vince is intimidating. The rest of us, not so much.
Brace the night, people.